स्वयं रूप कदा मई हम कदाति स्वपदांतिकम देहम श्री गुरु श्रीयुता पद कमलम श्री गुरु वैष्णवांश्च सजीवं साधुतं सावधूतं वैष्णवसहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधा कृष्णपादां सहगणाललिता श्रीशाखान्वितांश्च नमाम विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामी नामिने नमस्ते सरस्वती देवे पौराणी प्रचारिणे विशेषाशून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देश कारिणे वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्यैव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे
हरे कृष्णा. I welcome you to this Sunday program. So today, as the topic was announced, I'll be talking about Karana, word of honor or life of honor. Many times when we think about ancient books like the Ramayana or the Mahabharata, people get this question, these are events that happened long time ago, how are they relevant to our life? So one of the things which defines as a common characteristic the life of everyone is that all our lives are shaped by two things. One is what happens to us, and second is how we respond to it. What decisions do we make in our life and what events happen to us? For example, if a person is rowing a boat, now, when the person is rowing a boat, where that person will go will be determined by two things. One is, of course, where the person wants to go and where the person chooses to row the boat and take it. But the other factor is in which direction the current is blowing, how the waves come, how the storms come. So these two factors, our motivations and our compulsions. Motivations means what we choose to and decide to do. And compulsions means what is forced upon us, what events transpire beyond our control and events happen to us accordingly. So these two are common factors that are there for everyone, whatever be the age, whatever be the place, whatever be the other material considerations. Everybody's life is shaped by their motivations and their compulsions. Now, one of the things that we do observe right from early life is that life is not fair. Life is not fair. At least it does not seem to be fair. Now we see that different people have different attributes. Some people are born wealthy. Some people are born not so wealthy. Some people are born with very good looks. Some people are not born with so good looks. And even whatever be the starting point in our life, that itself varies. But along the journey of the life also, different kinds of things happen. And we are not always able to find a rational reason why things happen that way. So if we look at both the Ramayana and the Mahabharata, apart from the distinct individual characters and the very profound lessons that those characters illustrate, one common denominator of both these epics is how to face adversity with integrity. How to face reversals, problems, injustices in life with integrity, with dignity, with morality. If we look at the central characters of the Ramayana, it's Lord Ram, Sita, even Lakshman. You know, they all suffered for, if we look at just from that life's perspective, no fault of theirs. And if we look even in the Mahabharata, central characters, the five Pandavas and their wife Draupadi, they suffered for no fault of theirs. So the whole story is about how to respond to adversity with integrity. Now, there have been, just as in the Indian tradition, there are these epics. In the Western tradition, there were many Germanic sagas, Iliad, Odyssey, and then Shakespeare penned his classics. And most of these famous stories, now many of them don't have any historical basis or have only partial historical basis. But most of them are tragedies. So there are a whole set of events, and at the end of the events, it ends in tragedy. In contrast, the Ramayana and the Mahabharata both depict tragedy. Tragedy after tragedy after tragedy. But they don't end in tragedy. The end is because the characters follow dharma, so there is a glorious end. At the scene of this world, Shakespeare says this world is a stage. So on the stage of the world, whatever story is, it is going to be ending. But overall, what the Mahabharata and the Ramayana show is that one who lives a life of virtue, of dharma, triumphs. Now, this is a common lesson in both these books. But the Mahabharata makes things a little more complex. In the sense that there are characters with varying shades of grey in the Mahabharata. As compared to the Ramayana, where relatively speaking, it's quite clear, white and black. So one of the characters who falls in this spectrum of grey is Karna. And Karna is actually, if we hear his story, is a character it is easy to sympathize with. Because we see that he faced injustice. He was born, but then he was cast away for no fault of his. And then, although he had an illustrious birth, he did not get the credit of his birth. And then he rose despite all these advantages and attained a great fame as a warrior. But in the end, he was unjustly killed. This is what the story may seem like. And if this is the story that is there, then actually, if this itself were the complete story, then the whole purpose of Mahabharata, you know, the Mahabharata concludes with saying that, now in this way I have told how dharma triumphs, how dharma protects. And yet, why is it that people do not follow dharma? So if the story of the Mahabharata is to demonstrate how dharma triumphs, then would the Mahabharata show a person who, in his own way, was a noble character, him failing or him being victimized by injustice? No, we have to go deeper to understand what this character actually demonstrates. So as this title of this class is, A Word of Honor or Life of Honor. So this was actually the choice of Karna when Krishna approached him. After the Pandavas completed their exile, 12 years in the forest, 1 year incognito, then they asked for their rightful claim. And Dhritarashtra dilly-dallied. And first Drupada's Brahmin messenger went, and then Dhritarashtra did not give any answer. He said, I'll send Sanjay. He sent Sanjay, and Sanjay basically told that, you know, you have lived in the forest, just continue to live in the forest and be peaceful. So then Krishna himself came as a messenger, and Duryodhana obstinately rejected Krishna's peace proposal. So the next morning, before Krishna left, he asked for a private meeting with Karna. And at that time, this was the choice that was presented to Karna. Krishna told him that you are actually the eldest of the Pandavas, and you are meant to be the king of the world. And if you reclaim your position as the eldest Pandava, that is what you will get. Don't stay on the side of the evil Kaurava and meet with destruction. So now, what was Karna thinking about at this time? This was not the first time that Karna had come to know that about his parentage. Kunti had come to him before, and he had known that he was actually the son of Kunti. So he told Krishna, yes, I know it. But he said that I have given my word to Duryodhana. He says, he helped me in my time of need. When I was being dishonored, he protected my honor. And I gave him my word of honor that I will be his friend always. How can I betray him now? It is because of his trust in me that he has ventured on this war. And if I betray him now, I will be deemed a coward. I would rather die. And I know that I am going to die. Just yesterday night I had a dream. In that dream, I saw that Yudhishthira was dressed in white and he was being raised in a magnificent chariot which is going towards heaven, skywards. And Duryodhana was dressed in black and he was on the back of a donkey and he was shaved and he was being dragged downwards towards the lower regions. So I know what portents mean. And I know that I am going to die. Bhima will kill Duryodhana and Arjuna will kill me. But still, I will not give up the side of Duryodhana. And then Krishna had come on his own chariot with Satyaki and Karna had come on his chariot. So for this private colonization, Krishna had asked Karna to come on his chariot and Satyaki had gone on Karna's chariot and they were following behind. And Krishna embraced Karna and he said that if that is your decision, then our next meeting will be on the battlefield. So now here, at one level, Karna seems to have made a very heroic choice, embracing death for the sake of friendship. However, one of the most important lessons of the Mahabharata is that morality is never categorical. It is always contextual. Morality means what is right, what is wrong, what is true, what is false. This is never categorical. Categorical means this is one category. These actions are right and these actions are wrong. Reality is very multifaceted, very unpredictable, very subtle. And what may seem to be right in one circumstance may be wrong in another circumstance. So morality cannot be determined divorced from context. So to speak truth is a moral principle. But if by speaking truth, some harm is going to be done. If some criminals are about to kill an innocent person, and that innocent person is hiding, and we know where that person is hiding. In fact, the Puranas tell a story roughly like this. Once there was I won't go into the whole story, most of you know that story also. Once a butcher was chasing a cow, and the cow, a Brahmin was sitting on the crossroads, and he saw the cow just fleeing in one direction, and the butcher came running. Tell me, where is this cow gone? So now this Brahmin was in Dharma Sankat. He had taken a vow that I will always speak the truth. And if he speaks the truth, the cow will die. If he doesn't speak the truth, his vow will go. So now what should he do? So speaking truth is a moral principle. But when morality is divorced from the context, then what is moral, what seems moral, can actually turn out to be immoral. So he decided to stick to the truth. And eventually, basically, he decided, okay, I cannot speak of false, but I don't want to be the cause of the death of a cow. So what he did, in the robbery, he just pointed with his hands. Cow has gone this way. And the whole story goes on. Next life, you know, he for no fault of his, at least from that life's perspective, his arm hands were cut off. So the hands that he pointed, they were cut off in the next life. So the point is, morality is never categorical. Morality is always contextual. So what is right and what is wrong has to be determined by looking at the context. And yes, now if we look at Karna, he was in a situation where he was being, his honor was being impinged upon. He was in the situation of being insulted. No, there was Dronacharya's martial exhibition was there after he had trained all the warriors, Kauravas, Pandavas, and others who had come to his Gurukul. So they were all exhibiting their skills, and Arjuna was the matchless warrior among all of them. And then Karna marched in over there. And Karna said, whatever Arjuna has done, I will do better than that. And when the exhibition started, actually Karna tried everything that Arjuna did, and he matched it. Although he had claimed he would excel, he couldn't excel, he matched everything. And then he asked for a duel. And when they asked for a duel, I won't go into the whole story here, we're looking at the broad principles. Basically, he was told that the duels can be among equals. So we know Arjuna's parentage, tell us what is your parentage. And then he hung his head down, and later on became revealed that he was not from a Kshatriya parentage. So at that time, Duryodhana came to his rescue. And Duryodhana gave a very strong anti-casteist speech. He said, do you think that a lion can be born from a dog? Just look at this warrior. Look at his arms. Look at his body. Look at his carriage. Look at his speech. Look at his skill. Do you think that such a person can have any lineage other than that of a Kshatriya? He says, those who think that Kshatriyas are by birth, they are fools. And still, if you think that is like that, he has to be a king, then I will make him a king. And at that time, Karna felt so indebted. Karna told Duryodhana, how can I ever repay you? Now actually, Karna at that time had no idea about Duryodhana's evil intentions. And he felt Duryodhana is helping me. Now actually what had happened was, previous to this, Duryodhana had been always burning in envy, seeing Bhima's power. And he had been practicing tirelessly to try to equal and excel Bhima in mace fighting. But he had felt that there's no match to Arjuna. And the moment he saw Karna, he thought, yes, Karna will be the foil for Arjuna. And actually, he simply manipulated Karna. And when Karna said, what can I do for you? So Duryodhana, he was a brilliant politician. So he said, all that I want is your friendship. That's what Duryodhana said. He says, that you will have till my dying breath. That's what Karna told him. So now at this particular point, Duryodhana did help Karna. And it is good to be grateful to anyone who has helped us. But that commitment to do certain thing, it cannot be divorced from the context. Eventually, as things transpired, Duryodhana became more and more vicious. And if we look at the Mahabharata, Karna enters in the Adiparva, where the incidents are happening. And actually, Karna's moral uprightness and his disapproval for Duryodhana's evil ways, it's very evident in the beginning. Initially, when Duryodhana and Shakuni are conspiring to send the Pandavas to Varanavart and let them be burnt. So Karna says, why are you doing all these things? You know, let's call them for a fight. Let's challenge them and defeat them in a war. So now Karna has a lot of confidence in his own fight, in fighting skills. So Kripa tells him later, just before the Virat War, he says, you are like a cloud which roars but never pours. So, but Karna, he said, don't try all these things. So just call them for a fair fight. So here Shakuni said, you know, actually fighting should be the last resort. That is true. Fighting should be the last resort. But before fighting should come reconciliation. So Shakuni said, no, fighting is the last resort. First we will use cheating. So Karna opposed at that time, sending the Pandavas to Varanavart and getting them burnt. And then later on also, when the Pandavas came out of the forest, they won Draupadi. And because now they had alliance with Drupada, they could no longer be neglected. So when in the Kuru assembly, Dhritarashtra, Bhishma, Duryodhana, they were all discussing, what should we do now? So the elders, Vidura, Bhishma, they were counseling that, call Pandu's sons back and give them half the kingdom. So Karna said, no, the kingdom belongs to Duryodhana and it should go to Duryodhana. He had his own twist of logic. His idea was that Dhritarashtra had been the elder son and therefore his son should become the next king. But actually, although Dhritarashtra had been the elder son, he had never officially become the king. Because he was without eyes, so the throne had passed on to Pandu. And when Pandu had retired and eventually died, Dhritarashtra had only been a caretaker. And anyway, if the kingdom had to go on, in the next generation, Yudhishthir was older than Duryodhana. So if at all Duryodhana had any claim, at the most it could be to half the kingdom, not to full kingdom. But Karna said, let's challenge them and let's fight. Let's fight with them. And we will defeat them. So again, the Kuru elders disapproved. And then they were brought and they were given half the kingdom. That was the kingdom of Khandava, which by Krishna's mercy became Khandava Prastha and then Indra Prastha. And then later on, when Yudhishthira Maharaj decided to perform the Rajasuya Yajna. So at that time, because the Yajna was being performed inside the family, so Duryodhana, he thought, I should perform the Rajasuya Yajna, not Yudhishthira. But because it was the Kuru dynasty which was getting the glory, he could not oppose it. So he told Karna, you oppose it. So Karna was the king of Anga. And at that time, the four Pandava brothers were sent in the four directions. Arjuna went in the north, Bhima went in the east, Nakula went in the south, Sahadeva went in the south, and Nakula went in the west. And they conquered the four directions. So at that time, Karna fought with Bhima. Bhima came and he said, we have to offer tributes. He said, no, fight. And Bhima and Karna had a fierce fight which went on for several days. And eventually, Bhima overpowered Karna. And then, Karna agreed to pay tributes and he came along with Duryodhana because he was a friend of Duryodhana. So at that time, he was also given an honorary post and he was also serving in the Rajasuya Yajna in the administration. But Karna wanted to have a fair fight. But thereafter, when the gambling match was proposed, we see that slowly but surely, the bad association of Duryodhana and Shakuni starts rubbing off on Karna. And here, when they propose the gambling match, the Mahabharata does not report any opposition by Karna. He goes along with it. Actually, when the gambling match takes place, Karna not only goes along with it passively, but he goads the Pandavas actively. In fact, he insults. You know that when Draupadi actually, when the Pandavas lose everything at that time, and eventually they lose Draupadi also. So it is Karna, you know, who suggests that Draupadi let her be brought into the assembly. And it is he who says that, you know, she is a serving maid now. And we can do whatever with her, we should disrobe her. And then, when the assembly erupts and says, she's an honorable lady, how can you like this? So Karna, he says, what kind of honorable lady is this? A woman who has married five husbands, she's already a prostitute. So whether she's brought in front of the public without clothes or whatever, she's already degraded herself. We are not degrading her any further. Now, you know, for any, the word kshatriya, kshatatrayate iti kshatriya, one who protects people from hurt, and especially among the people, there are five classes of people who are protected. One of them is women. So for a kshatriya, or a person who claims to be kshatriya, to so viciously insult a virtuous woman is extremely despicable. And actually, there is no logic to it. Now, it was not that Draupadi went out of her way to get five husbands. Now, there was a Swayamvar in which one husband won her. But because there was a previous life situation, and because Kunti said that whatever you have got, you should share among the five, and Vyasdev certified it. So therefore, she had five husbands. But she did not go out of her way to get five husbands. And she was in no way like a woman of the oldest profession. So to compare her with like that was a grievous insult. And actually it is in the gambling match that Karna comes out at his worst. At his worst. Not only does he call Draupadi evil names, but along with that, he also opposes and silences Vikarna. Vikarna is the least vicious among the 100 Kaurava brothers. And when Draupadi is dragged into the assembly, at that time Vikarna opposes it strongly. And he says this whole gambling match should be declared null and void. Because Yudhishthir was forced to fight against his will because Shakuni cheated. And because Yudhishthir was under the influence of a gambler's mania, all that has happened should be rejected. And the Pandava, all their kingdom should be returned back. So at that time, the whole assembly approves of that. But then Karna jumps up and he, with his huge shoulders, he silences everyone. He says, this Vikarna, he is forgetting his position in this assembly. Now Karna is forgetting his position also. If it's a matter of position, there are elders to both Karna and Vikarna. They are in the same generation. But he says he's forgetting his position. He doesn't know what is right and what is wrong. He says, Yudhishthir, he voluntarily chose. Nobody forced him to gamble. And there is no, who says that it was a cheating? There was no cheating over here. And basically he refutes everything. And where the injustice could have been stopped, he not only did not stop it, he stopped the efforts to stop it. So he, as you know, different incidents, you know, bring out different facets of a person. It is said adversity introduces us to ourselves. You know, who we are, we can put on a very nice facade, but when troubles come, our true colors come out. So here, actually, Karna, although he is in many ways honorable, here he comes out in his to his worst. So now at this particular situation, we're going back to the life of honor or the word of honor. So Karna had to make a choice. And his choice was whether to go on the side of the Pandavas or the Kauravas. Yes, he had decided, he had given the word that I will help Duryodhana. But under what circumstance and to what limit should one go? Yes, we should be grateful, but we cannot divorce gratitude from the other values of life. We know that, especially as a provocative example to illustrate this point, it's well known that in certain poor parts of Pakistan and Afghanistan, these are the Arabic Muslim countries which are relatively poverty stricken. So there, often young children, especially males who are poor, they are recruited by terrorists. And faced with a life of starvation and death, they willingly agree to become machines of destruction and death. Now, when these children are starving and at that time they are helped, now they may feel grateful, and it's right to feel grateful. Somebody saved me from starvation. But just because somebody has saved me from starvation does not mean that I join that person in killing hundreds and thousands of innocent people. So actually, what Duryodhana did was despicable. And what Karna, not only dishonoring and dispossessing the Pandavas and their wife, but the whole insidious plan to go about it. And having no remorse at all, and just increasing one's maliciousness more and more. And Karna went along with it. So Krishna told him that you are, you'll be ruined by your sense of mistaken loyalty. Mistaken loyalty. One should be loyal, but to whom should be one loyal? So now some people argue that actually Krishna was afraid that if Karna is on the side of the Kauravas, then the Pandavas will not win. And that's why Krishna tried to cause a defection. Defection means you try to split the opposite party and get somebody from the opposite on your party on your side. So was the case that was Karna superior to Arjuna, because of which Karna was approached by Krishna? Now, if you look at the history, we can look at various times whenever there was an encounter between Karna and Arjuna. So we will keep a scorecard and we'll see who gets how much. So the first encounter between Karna and Arjuna is in Drona's martial exhibition. So Arjuna exhibits his skills, and then Karna comes and exhibits similar skills, more or less the same level of proficiency. And when there is about to be a duel between them, the sun sets. So it's a draw. The score is Karna 0, Arjuna 0. Now after that, both the Kauravas and the Pandavas approach Dronacharya that what Guru Dakshina can give you. So at that time, Drona says that arrest Drupada and bring him to me as a prisoner. Drona and Drupada have an old rivalry. And both the Pandavas and Kauravas are ready to charge ahead. Now Duryodhana, he wants to go fast, first. Because he thinks, you know, the Pandavas bested us in the martial exhibition, at least now we will best them. So as they are charging ahead, Arjuna tells his brothers, wait, let them go first, we'll go afterwards. So now, as the Kauravas start going along, Karna also goes with them. Because now he has become a friend. Although, he's not a disciple of Duryodhana, but he feels, I should help them in whatever we can. And then, the whole Kauravas, 100 Kauravas, along with Karna, charge onto Drupada's kingdom. And they challenge Drupada, and there's a fierce war. And after a fierce war, Drupada defeats them. Drupada defeats them, and the Kauravas, along with Karna, humiliated, they flee from there. And then the Pandavas charge in. And Arjuna and Bhima lead the charge, and Arjuna overcomes Drupada, and Bhima overcomes the commander of Drupada. And within a short while, Drupada is imprisoned and brought before Drona. So here what happens? Drupada defeats Karna and Arjuna defeats Drupada. So by inference, what has happened? Karna is superior to Arjuna. So Karna won, so Arjuna won, Karna 0. So now, after this, there are no direct encounters for a long time. The Pandavas are exiled and various things happen. But then, during the exile, the nature of greed is that one is never satisfied by getting what one wants to get. So now Duryodhana has become the world emperor. But still he is not satisfied. He thinks, you know, my joy will not come by my joy. My joy will come by the Pandavas' misery. It's a very peculiar definition of happiness. Envy, you know, greed leads to envy along with it. See, in envy, what happened to him? He said that we have to go to the Pandavas there in the forest near Kamyavan. And there we will, he says, I will go with my queens and my maidservants and my animals and I will exhibit my wealth. And then when the Pandavas see, oh, in how much poverty they are living and how much prosperity I am living, then when they see this contrast with their own eyes, then they will realize how fallen they are. And when they feel miserable because of that, then I will feel joyful. So with this plan, Duryodhana went to the forest. And now, Indra saw this. And Indra sent some Gandharvas to interrupt. And the Gandharvas said, so there was a Kamya, Dvaita one was a river. It's a pond, big pond. And they were on one side, the Pandavas, they were doing a sacrifice. Yudhishthira was heading sacrifice. And the Kauravas started flaunting their wealth on the other side. So the Gandharvas came there and said that this area belongs to the gods. You cannot come over here. So Duryodhana said, I am the king of the world. This belongs to me. He said, you get out of here. The Gandharva said, you fool. Who do you think you are? You are a human and you are ordering us celestials. He says, get out or you will die. So Duryodhana said, for your insolence, you will die right now. I will not give you a chance to get out also. So he and his army charged on the Gandharvas. And now, initially the Gandharva commander did not fight. He just got his Gandharva soldiers to fight. And they were slowly overpowered. And then the Gandharva commander, he got up. he started fighting fiercely. And then he started overpowering all the warriors. So he wounded Dushasana, he wounded Shakuni. And they both fled. And after that, Karna came forward. And the Gandharva attacked Karna. And Karna got severely wounded. And finally, realizing that he was no match, Karna turned and fled.